Can you hear me, Dean? Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome each and every one of you this morning and all the millions at home watching on TV. Welcome. Want to bring any announcements to your attention. Just make sure you check out the bulletin for upcoming Sundays, and just maybe put in your calendar the 14th. We all know the 14th is important anyways, but evidently Jeff will be a good time. So
I say Jeff will be a good time?
No, it says I will be a good time, and we're all assuming it's you. We're hoping for the best. No. Just make sure you check out your bulletin. Yeah. And if you're able to watch it online on the YouTube channel or something, we try to do a little thing with the announcements so that you don't miss out on any announcements. But if you do, just make sure you check us out on Facebook too. So do we have any other announcements? Okay. Be sure to see your bulletin as well for the prayer concerns. Continue to pray for Susie and Joe as well. Do we have any other prayer concerns?
Joe just did want to say thank you for the cards and letters. He did test negative, and so he's going to Chicago tomorrow to do an esophageal ultrasound. But he was really grateful for all the cards.
Any other prayer concerns? Okay. If you would please join me for a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we thank you for this morning. We always know when the snow comes, it kind of changes our landscape and gives us a new day. We'd ask that you would be with each one of those mentioned here today, the prayers, Susie and also Joe, and any others that are unmentioned here this morning, that we would pray that you would comfort and ease their pain and continue their progression and their healing. We'd ask that you would be with those that are unable to be here today, that you would continue to watch over each and every one of them. We ask that the service today would be a blessing to you. In your heavenly name, amen. Okay. Ladies, if you'd want to come up.
Just an update on the bruise. Susie's done with the treatment. So, they've done what they would want to do. This could be normal. So, hopefully, it would work. She's going to have most likely
Lord and Savior, I give myself to Thee, for Thou in Thy atonement didst give Thyself for me. I own no other Master, my heart shall be Thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for Thee alone. Living for Jesus, who died in my place, bearing on Calvary my sin and disgrace, such to answer his call. Follow his leading and give him my all. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee. For thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Living for Jesus wherever I am, doing each duty in his holy name, willing to suffer affliction and loss, as part of my cross. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee. For thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone. Living for Jesus through earth's little while, my dearest treasure, the light of his smile. Seeking the lost ones, he died to redeem. Bringing the weary to find rest in him. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee. For thou in thy atonement didst give thyself for me. I own no other master, my heart shall be thy throne. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Our next song is Jesus' Name Above All Names.
Beautiful Savior.
On the front of your bulletin, you can follow along with a reading of the scripture today from 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. God bless the reading of the word. If you would pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Brian, could I get a favor from you? Could you go to my office and grab those suckers off my desk?
Suckers?
Yep. I need some candy. Kids, come on up. Come on up. Come on up. Let's get this out of the way. Oh. Get it out of the way so you can see the munchkins. Hi, sweetie. How are you guys? Man, you guys all look so nice. Love your hair. I'm having a bad hair day. Actually, I'm having a bad hair year. I've discovered some things. This has nothing to do with what we're going to talk about, but I, because of the CPAP machine, it's this thing you have to wear at night so you can breathe. And it's like an astronaut going into space, but it puts a dent in the top of my hair. I couldn't figure out what was going on, but I have this dent. Just like, why is there a dent in your hair? It doesn't matter, does it? It's frustrating, so frustrating. Okay, he found them. Would you guys like a sucker?
Yes.
All right.
I can only find two.
Thank you, brother. Tell you what, I'll give you one in a minute. Oh, well, no, I'll give you one now. There you go. Go ahead. Here you go, big guy. All right. Are you guys familiar with the word love?
Yes.
What do you think the word love means? Go ahead.
You care for someone.
You care for someone. Very good. That's excellent. Anybody else want to say anything? What you think love means? You care for someone? Anything else? Well, let me ask you this. Do you, other than your mom and dad, do you love anything? Is there something that you love? Like, really? And I would say you think about it. You want to spend time with it. Is there anything that you love? When I was your age, I had a dachshund, and it was named Misty, and I loved Misty. I loved that dog. Have you ever loved a pet?
Yeah. Like, Lydia's dog, named Misty, that little dog.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, you love him. Casey loves him. Me too.
Yes. You're so cute. Do you have a dog?
Yes.
Do you love your dog?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Sky.
Sky?
Yeah.
Do you love Sky?
But she jumps up on us.
And she bites you. Now, if she if she bites you, is that very loving?
No.
No. Do you bite her back?
No.
You ever see anybody do that where a dog bites them and they bite the dog back? Don't do that. Do you have a pet? What's your pet's name?
Red.
What is it?
Red.
Red? Do you love Red? Yeah. pets, and when you love something, do you spend a lot of time with it? Does it sleep in your room with you?
No.
No? No?
My mom doesn't have pets in the house.
Oh, she does. Well, she's a good mom. Does Red stay in the house with you? Yeah. Does she sleep in your room? Does she? She makes you feel safe, doesn't she? Yeah. There, dogs and cats and, I don't know, have you ever had hamsters or turtles or... You had a guinea pig?
Yeah, I also have fish in my room.
Do you love your fish? What's the fish's name?
Jeffrey.
Really? I should pay you. All right. Yes. Yeah. You have three cats?
Mystery and Spice and Abe.
Mystery, Spice, and Abe.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, that's funny. I have a cat, and I'm not necessarily a cat person, but
what
I... His name is Smokey. Smokey. And I'm not going to lie, I really like Smokey. I do. I wish I could bring him into the house more often than I do, but my wife won't let me. Do you have something to say about that?
No.
Okay. I'd like to introduce Smokey to Jeffrey. Okay. All right. Anyways, my point is simply this. We have things in our life that we love, that are important to us. And if we love them, we like to be around them, we like to spend time with them, and they're just things that really, really, really matter. Now, beyond your pets, is there anything else in your life that you really, 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 really love?
Yes.
Yes. What do you really, 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 really love more than anything else?
Horses.
You know what? I believe that. I believe that you love horses.
I have a little horse named Sparky.
Sparky?
Yeah.
Do you ride Sparky?
No, he.
He rides Sparky?
And Colton do.
Oh, that's exciting. Is there anything that you love more than you love your pets?
No.
No? Grandparents. Ooh! Yeah, grandparents are special, aren't they?
Yeah.
They are. Cute. They're very special. How about you? Is there anything you love more than your pets? Bunnies? Bunnies are cute. They're very adorable. Well, let me...
What about hamsters?
What about what?
Hamsters.
Hamsters? Yeah. I used to have a hamster, but he would bite my finger all the time. And then he mysteriously got away. I want to tell you, we're going to talk about this for the next 3 weeks. We're going to talk about love. And Brian read this love passage. Love is patient, it's kind, it's all these things. And it's a picture of how God loves us. And so God loves us more than we love our pets, even more than we love our moms and dads or our grandparents. God loves us to the moon and back. Have you ever heard anybody say that? I love you to the moon and back?
Once or twice.
Once or twice? Yeah. Just because to the moon and back, that's a big deal. It's like, I love you this much. And God says, I love you this much. And we're going to talk about how he loves us so much. But the question is, do we love God like he loves us? Something to think about, okay?
Yes.
Something to think about. And so take your sucker and go on back and sit down, and we'll talk about it a little bit, okay? You guys were great. Really, a fish named Jeffrey. Let's see. That's a... Wow. Don't know how to feel about that. Tell you what, turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 22. We're going to talk about love. And yes, we are going to have some fun on Valentine's Day because it's on Sunday. And so we'll have with the couples that show up that they'll salt it, we might have a little newlywed game with some prizes. I should tell you now because some of you are going to have to go home and study. And you'll be home and like, hey, what's our favorite song? Or, things that you should know about each other, like, I'll never forget, I think Jen and I played one time, it was like, what color is your wife's eyes? Anyways. They're brown. Hazel. Hazel. Brown Hazel. It's like going to Lowe's looking for paint. All right. Clearly, I need to work on my marriage. All right. Love. So we began with the Corinthians passage, but we're going to explore that passage in the next couple of weeks. But I want to talk about love. It's the hardest thing to do. You think it would be the easiest thing to do, but the truth is it's not. It's the hardest thing to do. I think for love to be successful, it takes single-minded devotion, attention, and effort. It takes our full, you know, attention. And if you haven't figured it out yet, the world is designed to distract you from the things that matter most in your life. I'm a fan of Soren Kierkegaard, and this is one of his quotes that's one of my favorites. Purity of heart is to will one thing. And what Kierkegaard was saying was, it's difficult for us to be successful without single-minded devotion to something. And I think of this quote often when I think of love. Purity of heart is to will one thing. I want this so badly that I'm willing to adjust my life in order to have this one thing, to possess this thing, to love this thing. And I brought the kids up, and it was just kind of a spur of the moment thing, and as you could probably tell. And you know, our first love, what was your first love? It was probably a pet. I mean, yes, it was your mom and dad. But the truth is, as kids, that kind of comes naturally, and we don't think about it. Like the first time you ever passed a driveway where it said free puppies or, you know, kittens or whatever, and you were a child, and you're like, I have to have this thing, you know. You remember being a kid, and I remember a store called Mr. Wiggs. Do you remember Mr. Wiggs? It was in Fort Wayne. Maybe that wasn't a chain or something. It became Airway, which eventually became Target. Does anybody remember Airway? No, really? Am I that old? Burger Chef was across the street from Mr. Wiggs. Does anybody remember Burger Chef? And I remember throwing a fit for something, like a child would do. I remember throwing fits for a number of things. Not that that's normally how I do things, but, you know, stomping your feet and crying until your grandparents, it was grandma and grandpa who would buy. If you throw a fit, grandma and grandpa are going to buy it. They are. I think I did that once for a set of golf clubs, too. But I remember as a kid, there was things I thought that I loved, like Misty. I had two dachshunds, Misty and Ginger, and I loved them. I love little dachshunds. They're cute as a button. And I'm not a cat lover, but I'm drawn to Smokey. Smokey is so cute. Cats do the cutest things. They do. She'll come up and just lay on your feet. And I know she's licking you like I'm just tasting you, because eventually if you stop moving long enough, I'm going to eat you. But we love things when we're little kids. We want them so badly that we'll scream and we'll have a tantrum. And then we get it, and then this is what happens. Because I remember when Lizzie was like, I want a dog. And Lizzie was grown up, and she was like, I want a dog. You don't realize getting a dog is this huge responsibility. And so she got a dog, and then it becomes whose responsibility? It becomes your responsibility. But it starts good, because you get it, and you think, I'm going to feed it every day. I'm going to spend time with it. It's going to sleep with me. It's going to learn to do tricks. It's going to be wonderful. And then for some reason, and I think this is true with all things that we love, time changes that relationship. We feed it less, we spend time with it less. And the truth is, I think even in the things that we love that we would say are high on our list of appropriate loves, we do the same things. We get married, and at first it's like, oh, I want to sit here and look at you all the time. And then one day you get into a fight and you hear your wife say, I can't look at you anymore. You know, or not that that's ever happened for us. But we do. Things change. Suddenly the person that you want to spend all your life with, you find that you're spending time working more. Or you're doing things in... And then the bad news is bad things often happen which give us perspective. And again, for me, the best thing that ever happened to me was cancer, because it gives you perspective. It made me realize that the one thing that really mattered was just spending time with the people that I loved. And I remember I had this conscious thought, because I don't do a lot of pictures. I don't take a lot of pictures. I had this objective of trying to create memories instead of pictures, so that if I did die, my children would have these fond things to draw back on. Because the truth is, I'm not going to stop living if I die, so we shouldn't act like it's a bad thing. Death is part of sin, and we all die, and those who trusted Jesus, we're going to be born, we're going to be raised from the dead, and praise the Lord. But I wanted to leave memories, good memories, memories of loving and being loved and talking about God and talking about Jesus. But love takes work and it takes effort. And I think it's very easy for us to lose the luster of that first love. Do you understand what I'm saying? That it doesn't have quite the shine that it had in the very beginning. And so I want to talk about that. Could we contrast with humanity, the way that humanity loves, with God for a moment? Because Michelangelo, when he painted the creation on the Sistine Chapel, that's the picture of the creation of Adam, God is straining. He's reaching out, straining to touch Adam. It's like he's this big, buff painting of a male figure, but Adam is on the opposite end, and Adam's his arms outstretched, but his fingers just kind of dangling. He's not really striving or trying. God is trying to reach that which he created, and that which he created is only mildly interested in him. And so the Bible is a book with two stories intertwining. It's a story about God desiring to reconnect with that which he loves. And the other side of that story is that which he loves continually running away from the one that loves them. Which is funny. We do that all the time. Children, they'll grow up sometimes and they don't necessarily like the rules and they run away. People who've been in love for years, who haven't learned how to love appropriately, or they're used to being abused. When they're loved appropriately, they run away from that love, or they don't want anything to do with that love. And so the Bible is this story of these two things going on constantly. Israel is a people who constantly starts well but loses interest. God does something miraculous in their life, and then they wander off after other gods. They begin with an interest in their God, and they begin with an interest in their spouses and an interest in their children, but those things change. If you read the narratives in the Old Testament, they started with God, but they chased other gods. Well, they would start with their spouse, but literally there was a day when Israel came to Moses and said, "Can I have a certificate of divorce? Would it be okay if I divorced the wife that I said that I took?" And God hates divorce, and I'll tell you why he hates divorce. He hates divorce for this reason. Because we struggle to be consistent with one love. We can't love one thing fully. We have to love all these other things. And even with their children. Do you know, this is a sad thing. You never hear much about it. But within archaeology, child sacrifice was a pretty common thing. Actually, in Abraham's time, it was very common. It was the norm. In fact, today, if you would look at other cultures, they wouldn't say that they would sacrifice children, but there are cultures that still use blood of animals, in their spiritual worship. Santeria, voodoo, trying to think of some of the others, but blood is a part of, actually, they believe it adds power to their offerings when they make them. And I would imagine in all cultures that practice those kinds of things, they think if you were to offer blood of a human being, it would be the ultimate offering that you could give. And that was very common in Abraham's day. And so even their interest in their children wasn't the same as it should be. Instead of chasing the one who created their heart, they chased after created thing. And so let's begin our journey to Valentine's Day by exploring this strange word called love. And we're going to look at Genesis 22, which you might argue, what's this have to do with love? But it's the first example of the word love being used in the scriptures. We don't see it till Genesis 22. And it's actually used in the term is used of familial love, meaning family love, a father for a son, a parent for a child. And this is what it says in verse 1 of Genesis 22. And actually, before I read it, I just want to say this. As I read this, I want to be honest with you. When I read it, I know it's God asking something of Abraham, but whenever I read it, I imagine it's God actually talking about the very thing that he himself is going to do. He is going to explain something or ask something that only he, God, is able to do. And so it's difficult for me to read it without seeing it through the lens of a father talking about doing the impossible thing that has to be done for somebody else. And this is the account. In verse 1, it says, sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, Abraham, and he replied, here I am. And then God said, and I don't want you to miss this, take your son, your only son, whom you love. This is the first use of love in the Hebrew anyways, in the Old Testament, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. And early the next morning, Abraham got up and he loaded his donkey and he took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. And when he had cut enough wood for the burnt offerings, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abram looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship and then we will come back to you. Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac. And he himself carried the fire and the knife. Isaac carried the fire and the knife, and the wood. And the two of them went on together. Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, Father, yes, my son, Abraham replied, the fire and the wood are here. Isaac said, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together, and when they reached the place that God had told him about, Abram built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. And then he reached out his hand and he took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord, and here in the text, excuse me, the angel of the Lord would be a Christophany or a theophany. This is a manifestation of Jesus in person in this text before he becomes in the flesh in the New Testament. And he says, do not lay a hand on the boy. He said, do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. Abraham looked up, and there in a thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. And he went over and he took the ram and he sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the place, the Lord will provide. And to this day it is said, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. Lord, we ask a blessing on the reading of your word and the meditations of my heart. Teach us from your word as only you can by the Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to draw some inference to what Jesus is going to do because it's just littered all over within the text so that we can understand what God is asking of Abraham. He is asking him to do a hard thing. If God asked as a test any of us to do such a thing, for some of us, that would be an impossible task. We probably wouldn't do it. I think it's probably fair to say that God is a God who tests those who love him, and he challenges us to do things that we might not want to do. But I want you to understand something about God. He's not going to ask you to do something that would go against his nature and his the kind of God that he is. But the first thing that happens is he says, I want you to take this journey to this place that I'm going to show you. And that's not a new conversation. God actually said to Abraham in his hometown of Ur, he manifested himself to Abraham and he said, I want you to leave this place. The text tells us in Joshua that Ur was a place where they worshiped many gods. But God showed himself to Abraham and he said, if you leave this place and you go to a place I will show you, I will bless you. I'll make your name great. I'll make you into a great nation. I will do amazing things for you. And he did. He left that place and he followed God. So it's not unusual for Abraham to have heard God say, do something, go somewhere. But now he says, I want you to take a journey. And it's interesting. It's not an accident that this journey is 3 days. Because I ask you, how many days was Jesus in the tomb? He was in the tomb 3 days. Do you think the disciples for those 3 days thought that maybe things were different than they had been told? Actually, I imagine they were holed up thinking that this whole thing was a sham. That maybe we were led to believe something that wasn't true. Maybe there was great anxiety. First, there was this great feeling of loss over the one that they loved. I can't imagine. Actually, I can't imagine because I know what it's like to have a timeline put on your life. Because once you know that you only have so much time, things are different. You feel differently. What am I going to do in the 6 years that I have left? What am I going to do in the 3 years that I have left? What am I going to do in whatever the doctor caps it at? How am I going to live? How am I going to go on? What will I do? What will matter? Those 3 days were probably an intense 3 days for Abraham as he took this journey to Mount Moriah, as he thought about it. And I believe that what he thought may be different than what we think he thought. Because he knew God better than I think we know God in some capacities. He knew the God who called him from Ur and took him to a place. He knew the God who said, I'm going to make you into a family when he was almost 100 years old, who made his wife pregnant who was almost 100 years old. One miracle after the next. He was delivered from a king when he had to lie about who his wife was because he was afraid for his life. He was rescued from that king. And then it happened a second time. His servants went and beat 10 kings who took the people of Sodom and Gomorrah. He rescued Lot. This is a guy who has a relationship with God that's an important relationship. I think he knew things about God that maybe, as he says in the text, when his son says, Dad, where's the animal that we're going to sacrifice? The Lord will provide. The Lord's going to provide what we need. I know, as well as you know, that sometimes in that dark night of the soul, and life doesn't make sense, God is the only one who has all the answers. I know we like to do things in our own strength, but sometimes you just have to trust God and you have to take that journey. Wasn't Daniel, anybody remember how many days he was in the lion's den? Anybody remember what happened to the king while Daniel was in the lion's den? He prayed. He was there the moment that he knew that he could open the den, and they opened it and he's like, Daniel, are you in there? And he says, I am. I do know the anxiety of that period of time of waiting. What will happen? I'll tell you what will happen. Your God, my God, our God's going to do what he's going to do. Because that's who he is. And you know why he's going to do it? As this story will attest, because you and I can't. You and I can't do what only God can do. Let me go on. So I don't want you to miss that it was a three-day journey, a journey of intense prayer and maybe anxiety. And when he got to the place after his third day, he looked up and he saw the area of Mount Moriah. Now there is some aspect of discussion as to where in the area of Mount Moriah this took place. But most theologians believe it's actually the Dome of the Rock, which to Islam is sacred. It's supposedly the place where Muhammad was taken up and then he was carried up into heaven and then he actually came back. But it's also the place that Christians and Jews believe that Abraham offered Isaac. And we don't know that exactly, we surmise, but I can tell you this. Nobody doubts that the place that this happened is actually the place where Solomon built his temple. In 2 Chronicles, it said that David saw God on the threshing floor, I believe, of Araunah, and he ended up buying that, and that it's the old area of Jerusalem. It's not the new Jerusalem. That's where the Temple Mount was built by Solomon. It's the place where God said, I will what? I will provide. The temple. Some believe it may actually be Golgotha, which was about I forget how many kilometers it is away from that site, but it doesn't matter if it was Golgotha, it doesn't matter if it's the temple. It's the place where God set his home, where he set his seal, where he said, I will be your God and you will be my people. That was the place that he saw. That was the place that God took him. He took him to a place that would be significant, not only yesterday, but today and even tomorrow in our eternal lives. And then Abraham says, we will worship and we will come back to you. And as I already shared, Abraham knew something about God that I want to say we know, but maybe we don't know, that God has a plan, that God's going to see that plan through, that he's going to help us, that he's going to do what he said he would do. And it says that on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. And that's true. We're going to head to Easter and we'll talk about that, because Jesus is that Lamb of God that was provided. But here is this picture from Scripture of God describing something that only God is going to do. I can't offer my children to save myself, to save my life, to save humanity. It doesn't work that way. But God will. And I would argue that one of the most significant signs of this text is simply this. And I've not heard it preached probably till the last maybe 10 or 15 years. But I believe this is a more accurate understanding. In a time when it was common for people to sacrifice their children, Abraham was simply saying, or God was simply saying to Abraham, this isn't how we do what we do. This isn't our practice. You don't have to do that. Life is sacred. It matters. And here's what you need to understand. He said, I want you to take the thing that you love, and I want you to offer me this thing that you love. And God, did he take the thing that Abraham loved? Did he take it? Did he take it? He didn't take it. Because that's the kind of God he is. He doesn't take the things that we love. It's not that kind of God. In fact, I would argue that God spoils us rotten and gives us more things than we need. He protects and preserves the things that we love. He's not the God of the Old Testament that some people describe. I would argue, this happened for me in studying the Old Testament. I saw Jesus in the Old Testament more than I saw him in the New Testament. And I realized that grace abounds more in the Old Testament than it does in the New Testament. When Cain was guilty of slaying his brother,
when Cain was guilty of killing his brother, man's fear.
Did God demand his life? Did God demand his life? Did God kill Cain for killing his brother? You know what we call that? Grace. And I could go on with example after example after example in the Old Testament. Always bothers me a little bit. My dad will always say to me, I can believe in the Jesus of the New Testament, but I can't believe in the God of the Old Testament because he was mean and vengeful. Said, you really should read the Old Testament then. It's not two different gods, which actually was an early heresy in the early church, that there was a God of the Old Testament and there was a God of the New Testament. They're one and the same.
I already told you, who was it that showed himself to Abraham on the mountain? It was Jesus. Do not lay a hand on the boy. I know now that you love me. So, this thing I put on the cover is I looked at the 1 Corinthians passage. What's the first rule of love? And I have this passage, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it's not proud, it does not dishonor others, it's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. I love that one. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. It's the first rule of love. I'm getting there. There was a guy, I think his name's Joshua Rogers. I don't know who he is. I had friended him on Facebook. I think he's an author for couples and a lawyer or something like that. But some of you may know him. But he had asked married couples around Valentine's Day to give the best marriage advice. And what I saw he put on the other day had something to do with asking your spouse every day, what can I do for you? So of all the advice he got, that was the one that he picked. And it's interesting that back when I wrote this message earlier in the week, the first rule of love was, what can I do for you? What can I provide for you? How can I help meet your needs? I wasn't very good at love when I was a young man. My rule of love was, I love me and I want you. Sounds weird, doesn't it? But I did. I loved myself more than I loved anything else. And I loved things and I wanted things because they made me better. Right? So I picked this beautiful young lady because I thought she made me better. And I don't know that I even loved her as much as that I understood love. Because I didn't. Because the only thing I really loved was myself. And Jen understood that. And she wrote in my yearbook, I hope you find someone who loves you more than you love yourself. As I was looking at the Corinthian passage, these aren't things he's asking us to get. He doesn't say love is getting patience, love is, you know, getting kindness, love is getting envy. It's things that we have to do. It's things that we have to give. And they're things that we have to give when they're not easy to give. I'm growing up in my own faith. I met with my pastor's group the other day, and I think Joel asked me, he said, are you still learning? I have learned more here than I have in all my years of ministry. One of us, we have an enormous amount of time to study. So it's easy to learn. But the one thing that God's really working on me is you got to go out and find people that are hard to love and you have to love them. When you do that, then I think you're doing something. So how hard is it to love those who love you? Being here and loving you guys, that's a piece of cake. You got to go out and find some real winners. And you got to love them. Kindness, patience. So now I get it. Self-control. To the guy who opens his mouth and says the stupidest things all the time. That's the hardest thing for me. Self-control. You know what? And what a bonus. We live in a time when self-control among Christians, it would be great. We should practice it. Because people are always telling us something that goes contrary to what we believe, right? It does. Self-control. That's the darndest thing. It's not self-seeking. That's really hard for a guy who loves himself. It's not self-seeking. How can I do something more for my wife? Now, as a dad, I'm not a great parent. I want to be a great parent. It's funny. I'm more concerned about being a parent to my grown kids now than I was to when they were little. I just want them to know that I love them. And sometimes, like when I was a parent, where you give your kids everything, you know, I want to help my kids. I helped Lizzie last year. I made the mistake of helping her buy a car, and then that car broke down, and I worked to help pay to fix it because I love her. And I don't know if there's any rhyme or reason to it. I shouldn't have done it. It was, you know what I'm saying? I mean, some parents would say, don't help your kids, but this is my kid. And I got to be honest with you. My mom and dad were helping Jen and I a lot up until mom died. I remember when we bought the house on Bank and mom and dad came down and my brothers and them bought us all new appliances for this house that we bought. And I was probably 50 years old. Familial love. Probably one of the places where we learn to love the best, maybe, or love the most. People loving us in spite of us going out and making the same mistakes over and over and over and over. I love Genesis 22. I love it. I love the picture of a God who says, I'm going to do what you can't do. I'm going to give you what you can't do for yourself. I can't save myself. I can't save you. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. He's the God who provides. He's the God who calls. He's the God who sustains. How many of you have seen the movie Jurassic Park? The first one. About the middle of it, when the T-Rex comes out, and he tears up the two Jeep Cherokees or whatever they're there, and the kids are in them, and it goes over and the little boy is stuck in a tree in the car that was chewed up by a dinosaur and kicked over the edge, and he keeps saying to Dr. Grant, he said, but he left us, but he left us, but he left us, and he's talking about the lawyer who, when he saw the dinosaur, ran out of the car, and of course, you know what happened to the lawyer. It's a cruel irony. And Dr. Grant says, but that's not what I'm going to do. God says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. He is the God that does the thing that we can't do for ourselves. He's the God who provided Jesus so that his righteousness could be my righteousness. Don't think for a second that you are who you are because of what you've done. The only way you're going to stand before God is because of what Jesus has done, period. I don't care how good you are, how handsome you are, how anything else you are, how successful you are, how wealthy you are, the only way you'll stand before Jesus is because God has provided what you need. And because of that, we can interact with God. We can talk to God. We can hear from God. We can receive from God. We can know from God. We win. That's love. We win. I married Jen. I win. Every spouse should be like, yes, I married my wife. I win. Okay. Worship team, come on up. Oh. First rule of love, if you remember this and you continue to, and again, 1 Corinthians 13 should be a memory verse. I know it's this wedding verse. Any more people are like, I don't know that I want to use that at my wedding because everybody uses that. Yeah, let's not talk about appropriate love. The first rule of love, what can I do for you? Don't start with, what about me? What can I do for you? And you know what? Thank God that God created families the way that he did. Because you know what a parent does first thing in the morning? What do I got to do for them? How, you know, I got to make breakfast. I got to get them ready for school. I got to do this. I got to provide. I got to provide. I got to provide. I got to provide. And parents, you'll do it for the rest of your lives. Praise the Lord. You know, there used to be a time when a family stayed in the same home all their lives. Grandma and Grandpa were there. They were there. Their children were there. It's different now. It's different. What can I do for you? You know why I love Zion? Because that's true here. I have not met. I have. There have been nice people in church. But it hasn't been as much fun or as enjoyable to her. And that's a testimony to your own hearts. What can I do for you?
Please stand. Our song is Yes, I Will.
Same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail.
Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the snow. What a reminder of how you cover a multitude of sins and make all the things that we have done white as snow. And you've done it because of Jesus. And that's how you love us. You do what you can to make us right with you. Lord, help us to do what we can to be right with each other, to be right with the world, to show them the love of Jesus. That's the most important thing. Help us to be able to love like you love, and to love those that are hard to love, because you came after us when we were hard to love. We rejoice in that. Thank you for today, in Jesus' name, amen.